in the project Noskemus, I'm basically responsible for the whole digital agenda. But before I come to Transkribus and what we do with Transkribus, I want make some preliminary remarks concerning editorial principles in the field of neo-Latin studies. As for now, it seems there is no real consensus on editorial principles in the field of neo-Latin studies. There are two extreme positions. One position called
I think we lost the sound. Is that possible?
Yes, I don't hear anything.
No. Herr Zathammer, können Sie uns hören? Können Sie mich hören?
Minority not used by professional Latinists or classicists, but rather by neo-philologians, historians, theologians, lawyers, and so on and so forth. And I think with this point, there are three questions which are interlinked. If we want to make available Neo-Latin texts, we have to consider which texts are studied and are worth making or are worth that there is a digital edition or there is OCR for this text. Then we have the question, who's studies these texts? Are they studied by Latinists? Are they studied by historians? Are they studied by neo-philologians? Because all of these have different opinions on how a text should look and have different opinions how to work with this text. A couple of works to Noskemus, to the project. The project intends to decisively advance our understanding of the interrelation of Latin and science in early modern times. One big part of the project is a tripartite database, works, authors, and basic secondary literature based on Semantic Media Wiki with about 1,500 representative texts in terms of chronological spread, literary forms, and scientific disciplines. With the database comes together the digital source book, where we want to make available a machine readable text of all works which got the entry in the database. We are using Transkribus, and we present at the end basically a dirty OCR for full text search and not a corrected version by hand. And all texts are made accessible on the web via Transkribus' own written search environment, which I will show at the end of my presentation. As I said, we want to make all our works available in digital form, and we are using Transkribus for this. When I began to train the model for Transkribus, I saw four main problems. On the one side, the time frames. We have books from 5 centuries, basically from the 15th century until the end of the 19th century. Then a second problem was the variety of languages. All works which are in our database are of course primarily written in Latin, but many of them have a considerable amount of passages in other languages. For example, ancient Greek or ancient Neo Greek, German, Hebrew, English, Italian, and French. Then the third problem was the different typefaces. In the early modern times, there were many Greek typefaces and also many many variants of antiqua typefaces, but also many variants of black letter typefaces. We have the Textura, the Schwabacher, and also the Fraktur. And the problem with these typefaces is that because our books are mainly written in Latin, that we have not many training data to train our model with these typefaces. And the fourth problem were the abbreviations, especially the ambiguous abbreviations, how to deal with them. Here I have two examples from texts which we are dealing with. On the left side, we see a page from Vespucci's Mundus Novus, printed in Rostock in 1505. And on the other hand, we have the dissertation of Semmelweis, De Vita Plantarum, printed in Vienna in 1844. And here we have another example. On the left side, we have an edition of Theophrast's Liber de Lapidibus with a Latin translation and a Latin commentary. And on the other hand, side, we have a beautiful printed edition of Pietro Bembo, De Etna, which was printed in Venice in 1469 by Aulus Manutius. When I began the training of our Transkribus model, I set up some main guidelines. The main goal was searchability and readability. But in order to give the user at the end a maximum of freedom, standardizations which were required for the searchability and readability in the transcription process have been kept to a minimum. So normalizations have been implemented in the following cases. Ligatures and standard abbreviations have been expanded. Long S was transcribed as normal S. Small caps were transcribed as majuscules and special characters, for example, the e-caudata were kept. So when I had these transcription guidelines, I finally began to transcribe and to correct transcribed pages. The first step was that I trained one individual model for each century our project is dealing with. So at the moment we have a model for 15th and 16th century books, one for the 17th century, one for the 18th century, one for the 19th century. And we have two smaller models, one model where there are the books which contain Latin and but considerable passages in German, and one model where there are books which contain Latin, but also considerable passages of ancient Greek. For example, the Theophrast edition I showed a couple of slides before. Each special model consists at the moment of about 500 to 600 pages, taking from at least 10 different books or works. The works for the training data were selected with the aim of ensuring they are representative in terms of chronological spread and used typefaces. The goal was to get a massive ground truth which will be able to deal with most of our texts, and that we don't have to use the special or the individual models at the end for each century, but to get one general model. And with the training data of the special models, I trained one general model, which is going to be used for the whole collection. At the moment, it consists about, it has about 2,600 pages, and the character error rate lies about 0.5%. Our general model is still kind of in work in progress because there are a couple of known issues. There are occasional inconsistencies in the transcription of quotation marks, punctuation marks, and diacritics. The error rate for transcription of Greek words and passages is still high. I think the main problem here is the vast amount of different early modern Greek typefaces, and that I have not yet enough training material, because I think I have about 50 or 60 pages with Greek and not more. And there's one big problem for our model at the moment, how to deal with ambiguous abbreviations, because like I said at the beginning, we decided to expand the standard abbreviations for the sake of searchability and especially for readability. So this is at the moment, this is the biggest problem which needs to be solved. Also how to deal with abbreviations by contraction or truncation. My plan is to train a second model where no normalizations and standardizations are made, but where everything is kept like, or everything is transcribed like it is found in the book. And the goal is that you can then switch between the expanded text and the original text and get both transcriptions in the same document. So now let me share the screen and I want to give you a quick look at the Transkribus environment. Can you see the environment in Transkribus?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it basically it looks a little bit like in the presentation before. We get the image and then we get the transcription at the bottom of the page. One really good feature is the so-called keyword spotting, where you can search for words in a variety of spellings and you get all results. For example, I have here a book, Erasmus Encomium Artis Medicae, and there I searched for Plinius and I get all pages where Plinius, where the word Plinius is written, but I don't only get the pages where Plinius is written with I, but also where Plinius is written with Y, for example, here. So I think this, the feature of the keyword spotting is really helpful and will at the end, will make the work at the end much more easier than at the moment where you have to search with the correct spelling. Then let me just show where all these texts are then available in the web. Do you see the homepage with read and search at the top?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Now all our texts which are in the database are then linked to our digital source book where we use the read and search environment. Here we have a list of all works which are currently online. This should be about 150, but I'm continuously uploading new works. For the moment, there is only one standard index with the names of the authors, but in the end, there will be a more sophisticated, system and more detailed system on more detailed index. If you go for if you want to search for a certain word in the whole collection, then you just can search it here. For example, I search for balsamo. Then I get on the left side, I get there are all the books where the word was found, and also in how many places. And here I see the I see the page and the picture of the page. And when we open the page, then we see it is beautiful shown where the word which I search for is in this page. Then we have another very nice feature. If someone detects an error, or then it's easily correctable if you go via Transkribus Lite. Transkribus Lite allows you to correct the OCR directly in your browser. You just need to log in and then click on your document and search for the page. And then there you can easily correct all kinds of errors you found in the original transcription. For the moment, this is not possible for the whole community, but only for those who are affiliated with our project. But I hope that we can make it kind of that we can make it public for the crowd, and so that the crowd helps us correcting our texts and therefore also making our models even better in the near future. And now I want to give the word to Martin, and he will explain or show a little bit of the Semantic Media Wiki database.
Thank you, Stefan, and hello also from my side to everyone. Can everyone hear me loud and clear? Great. You just have heard our expert. I will now try to complement this by a couple of remarks by a total digital layman. And accordingly, I will speak from the point of view of a pure user, and I hope this will not be too boring for all of you. I also will focus complementarily to what Stefan has said to our Semantic Media Wiki, which I will try now to show you. Can you see it?
We see a sort of a start screen.
Okay. Is it better now?
Now we see a page which is entitled Main Page.
Yeah, perfect. Wonderful. That's it. I will speak about this tool, the Semantic Media Wiki, which is probably less innovative than Transkribus, but which is even more basic for my daily work and also for the work of all our team members. In fact, this database is filled collectively by all regular team members, and it is in a certain way the centerpiece of the whole project. all of us devote well considerable time and energy to filling the database, and all of us use it also as a working tool in turn every day. Now, the database basically has a threefold structure. It has an authors section, which you can see here. So early modern authors. Then it has a section with modern secondary literature. And finally, and most importantly, by far, it has a works section. So a section of early modern works we are presenting and describing. And as Stefan already explained, this section tries to be representative of early modern scientific literature written in Latin in three respects. In terms of chronology, we want to cover all the time span from the invention of printing to the early 19th century. In terms of disciplines, we want to cover all major disciplines, and above all, in terms of literary genre. And the whole is then intended to give something like a representative overview of early modern scientific literature written in Latin. Now, let me show a little more in detail how this looks. I will try to show you a specific entry. Yeah, here we have such entry. Now you can see it in full, I hope. This is an oration from the 17th century by a doctor who, given at the university in Halle, at the Saale, and basically this tries to convince people by a close look at human anatomy that something like creator God must exist. As you can see, the entry starts from a number of bibliographical things, the author, the full title, the year, the place, the printer, the era, and then the genre and the discipline it belongs to. And we also have it linked to a digital copy, I could show you here, but I will just return to the page. And then the heart, basically, of each entry is a brief but hopefully somewhat telling description, where we talk of things about here in the first paragraph, the context in which this text originated. And then we give a short overview in terms of content. We say something about the literary form and the style. And if the book has a reception history, let's say, to speak of, we talk also about this in the end. Now, how can you find what you are looking for in the database? And this applies not only to the team members, but everyone can have a look at the database and search for interesting things in it. First, we have a simple search by keywords. For example, I can look for Newton, and then I will get the author entry for Newton. I will get works written by Newton. And I will also get so-called page text matches where Newton is mentioned in the text of entries of primary literature or secondary literature. Or I can also say, okay, I'm interested in physical theology, an important notion in early modern times, and then I will get all places where something about physical theology is said. And on top of this, we have another finding device, which is our semantic drill down, which you can see here. And this is used not so much for finding a specific keyword or even a specific work, but we rather use it to find out which and how many works of a certain kind exist and to have, let's say, a global view of such works. You can see we have to descend a number of different categories. And if, for example, I want now to know how many and which 17th century dialogues on alchemy we have in the database, I first single out all the 17th century works. Then among these, I go for the dialogues. And among these, I go for the discipline of alchemy or chemistry. And then I find that we have two different books and I can have a look at them. And if I want to compare them, look for similarities, dissimilarities, and so on. Now, I'm already almost done with what I have to say. Why can I recommend semantic media wikis to people who do, let's say, projects similar to this one, but also to people who want to look for something in other people's projects? First, the thing is very easy and intuitive to work with. As you see, it has this Wikipedia technology behind it, and above all, the Wikipedia look about it, which we are all familiar with. Second, as I hope to have shown, it's easy to search. Third, it's also easy to change in its structure. The structure is quite malleable. For example, and now I go back a few steps. In the beginning, we had just one big category of encyclopedic works, but a couple of months ago, it turned out that there is a special kind of encyclopedic works which are much shorter than their usually long counterparts. And we created for them a special section of compendia. And last but not least, the Semantic Media Wiki allows one to get an overview of a whole field, and especially to notice things which one would not have noticed otherwise. For example, looking at this page, we see at one glance that of all disciplines, medicine is most strongly represented in early modern science. Now, this is perhaps not a big surprise, because it's also the discipline with the strongest institutional background, but it's nice to have this confirmed. Or I can see, looking at the genres, that we have quite a large amount of genres titled other. So we have big difficulties of assigning a genre to each work. And this points to the fact that early modern scientific literature is very, let's say, creative and experimental when it comes to literary form. Or if I would not now have a look at the category of letters, browsing through all these 50-something books, I would find that a number of them I have also under the category of monographs, which points to a specific subform, which one could term letter monograph. And I wouldn't know about this otherwise. Or if I would go through all the journal papers, I would find that we have now 5 or 6 Latin journal papers from the philosophical transactions in this database, although the philosophical transactions are are always said to be a purely English journal. And following this, I had a look at them, a closer look, and it turned out that in fact, in the first century of their existence, 10% of all contributions to the philosophical transactions were in Latin. So in one word, I think this database and the database of this kind in general is simply a great heuristic tool to find out new things. Thank you very much for your attention.